President Bola Tinubu has been re-elected for a second term as the chairman of the Economic Community of West African States, thus extending his leadership of the regional bloc. Tinubu, who took office in May of 2023, was reaffirmed during the 65th ordinary session of the ECOWAS Authority of Heads of State and Government. The session convened at the presidential villa in Abuja, Nigeria's capital, on Sunday, where leaders from West African nations have strongly opposed the withdrawal of Burkina Faso, Niger, and Mali, nations currently under military rule from the ECOWAS bloc. This consensus emerged during the ECOWAS summit in Abuja. The military regimes of these countries recently formed a new alliance and severed ties with ECOWAS. Well, Arise analyst Dayo Sobowale joins us now to discuss President Tinubu's re-election as ECOWAS chairman and take stock of his first year in office and the challenges that lie ahead. Good afternoon, Mr. Sobowale. Thank you for being here.
It's a pleasure to be here, Suja.
It's great to have you, as always. So from your perspective, if you could give a brief review about the performance of the Nigerian president as chairman of ECOWAS in the past year, how would you rate his performance?
Well, what is important now is the fact that he has been re-elected. You see, the past 1 year, there were more challenges, and more effort to try and put democracy on the ground and defend democracy, but that did not work out. And you see, the lesson I think we learned from that is that at times, domestic politics can influence international relations and diplomacy in a way that people do not expect, and it can have unintended consequences. Now we have ECOWAS is literally broken into two camps. You have the alliance of Sahel states, I would say the AS coalition, that is, this Burkina Faso, Mali, and Niger, who are military coups. And we are insisting, even as ECOWAS was meeting over the weekend, they had their meeting, and they insisted that they were no longer part of ECOWAS. So, in a way, trying to resolve the issue of good governance and democracy and trying to deter coups has been what Tinubu has been trying mainly to do in the last 1 year. Get me? But that has not been successful because these are military men who have taken over government in their various states, and they are contiguous to each other. They are pledged to support each other in case of any rebellion or in case of any external aggression. So let's leave it at that for now. What are your questions?
All right, but some of these military heads that you mentioned, their view about the ECOWAS, and some have also echoed it, is that the ECOWAS has become a bit antiquated and out of touch with reality, and is not fit for purpose for the modern times. So you mentioned something about...
They didn't say anything like that.
They said...
No.
They mentioned...
What they said, they were condemning France, that France was treating them as if they were nobody.
And they also mentioned ECOWAS. And the powers they wield here in Africa.
Look, let us discuss the issue on the ground.
That is the big issue on the ground.
What is the issue you are
discussing? The issue on the ground is what powers does ECOWAS have right now over its members to be able to rein them in? You spoke about governance,
Let me answer your question. What power does have? Very simple. Three states have military junta out of 15.
Yes.
But 12 are still around.
Yes.
And you were around there when ECOWAS wanted to form a military alliance. And Nigeria was, Tinubu had just been appointed. And he was at the forefront. Elected. And he was at the forefront of that. But you know what happened in Nigeria? You get me? The North Islamic leaders in the north persuaded him that the people in Niger are our cultural cousins and that we cannot start a war unnecessarily. And he heeded that advice. He wanted to deter on behalf of democracy that when coup plotters come in, they should be brought to order. But he was not able to achieve that. Domestic politics interfered in regional politics. And that was what stopped ECOWAS.
Hence the talk about ECOWAS being more of bark than bites.
That is you saying that.
No, this is ECOWAS, not me saying that. ECOWAS, this is what political analysts are echoing out there.
I am a political analyst. I'm telling you that.
And that is one opinion. Some opinions out there differ.
That's my own view, yes.
And the military junta's also differ from this opinion.
They've dared ECOWAS time and time again.
Look, and
I don't want to have this. If you cannot have a discussion, I will leave.
Mr. Sobowale.
I'm just asking questions here.
You are not asking questions?
All right. Laying
down your own viewpoint. Let me talk.
Okay, Mr. Sobowale.
Now that you've established,
you've looked at, in review, how the last year was in terms of the countries that left the bloc and whatnot. In terms of what lies ahead, now that he's been re-elected, what challenges do you think the president will face in this new tenor?
Yes, thank you for the question. Now, the dilemma ECOWAS has is that it has a divided house. But then, you see, he cannot wage war against these three because of domestic politics. Now, they have appointed the president of Senegal and Togo to go and deal and liaise with them diplomatically. Although they have not given up on what they want to do militarily, because they're asking the member states to make their contribution to the ECOWAS defense fund so that they can raise a force against military intervention. So that one is still ongoing. It is an unfortunate situation, but they have to cohabit. By cohabitation, you see, I want to dwell on one thing. This military junta people, in particular, accuse France bitterly of not treating them like human beings. Their bitterness is whether it is genuine or not, is another matter. Because France came to help them fight jihadists. You get me? In the process, when the French were killing jihadists, it's their own people who rallied around and said France cannot be killing their own people. And the French left. The Americans left. Now the Russians have come, the Chinese have come. So the geopolitical scene has changed. It has changed. And ECOWAS has to live with the fact that it has a splinter group, a minilateral group within its auspices. And it must find a way to deal with it, so that our ECOWAS does not fail totally. Like the president of Ghana said, even though the three are military, the rest are the elections, there are so many successful elections. Get me? But that the problem of the area persists, which is insecurity, poverty, jihadism, and political instability, and the quality of governance in democratic states. The panacea to that is for people to govern well and have free and fair elections. But then, to me, I will leave the junta in place. Let's see what becomes of them in six months' time. Because people will see their quality of governance, and you bet there will be another revolution against them. Just like it happened in Mali. The army came, drove out the civilian regime. Another military junta came and drove out the military people. So it is a pragmatic situation. Let ECOWAS take its time. Negotiate. Do not use force yet. Negotiate with these people. I'm sure by the time they see their style of governance, they will not be as popular. Juntas are popular on the immediate circumstances, very soon after any coup. But when people see that there is no equity, there is no inclusion, they'll be unpopular too. But you see, West Africans don't have stomach for any war now. Let's leave it at that for now.
Okay. I'll still ask. We're still looking at this Burkina Faso, Mali, and Niger, because they've gone on to sign a confederation treaty, and they are going on with their own plans, even though you call them a splinter cell away from ECOWAS. And they have decided to distance themselves from ECOWAS, I must say. And my own question to you is this. With all that has happened with these three countries I just mentioned, showing that we can do without ECOWAS, the big question will be, what's the relevance of ECOWAS in the world we live in today? What do they provide their member states that they cannot do on their own?
What's the question, please?
That's the question.
What's the question?
The question is simple. Okay, I'm going to reiterate. What is the relevance of ECOWAS in the world we live in today?
That's right.
If the member states like Mali, Burkina Faso... Let me finish my question. You asked me to ask a question. Let me finish the question. If those countries are already showing that we can't do without ECOWAS, the question is, what is the relevance of ECOWAS in the world we live in today?
Okay, you do not know the history of ECOWAS. If you know the history of ECOWAS, you will not be asking that question. ECOWAS is made of 15 member states. It's about to celebrate its 58th year. You get me? Nigeria is a member of ECOWAS, in case you do not know.
I know that.
ECOWAS, yes. Most countries had independence at 1960s. You get me? You are free from colonialism. Then military juntas came in the 60s. You get me? Then the world moved from military rule in West Africa, the world over, to a situation whereby democracy became the norm. You get me?
Mm-hmm.
But now these three nations, in the last 2 years or so, have had military regimes. I say military regimes are going to come back. ECOWAS is a community of West African states.
Yes, it is.
If you do not know.
Like the name says.
Wait. It is like the EU. It allows for free movement of goods and services. You get me? And it's supposed, governments are supposed to look after their people. And there are governments in place in all these places. But it is now being threatened by insurgency and climatology. You get me?
All right.
And these governments are still in place trying to bring
people to say thank you very much because we've run out of time.
So you know ECOWAS now?
But that didn't say answer my question all the same.
Uh-huh.
I want to say thank you very much, Mr. Dayo Sobowale, for your time here on News Hill.